Welcome to another episode of the official catch-up. It's Ben here, and I'm joined by Chris and the second best hat wearer in Lowland League football, Mozza. How are you doing?
Who's overtaking me?
Chris Guidis, obviously.
Obviously.
I actually had to think about that myself, but I did see your comment about where can you get... They do have a club shop, I believe, with our sponsors, I think, the Soccer Shop Direct. So
University are still need to sort us out with the Chris Guidis cap, because that's what we all need in life. Anyway, how you doing, Moz? All right?
Not bad, mate. How's you?
Good, man. It's been a few weeks. We haven't chatted much in the old Lowland League and all the other good stuff in Scottish football, but it's good to be back. Chris, how you doing?
Aye, it's an easy one today, actually. Scottish Cup is these ones are always easy, historically, because all the highlights are out. So don't have to really go in depth with too much, but happy to be on this, giving our opinions here and there again.
And obviously the Highland are rotten compared to the Lowland, so it makes our lives easier as well.
This year, it looks like.
Just let me fish, all right?
Usually 50-50, to be fair.
That's funny. Just a shout out to our sponsors, the Soccer Shop Direct. Find them on Twitter at the Soccer Shop D, or check out the website www.soccershopdirect.co.uk for all your team wear and football equipment needs. So, Scottish Cup, first round. We've had some Lowland League teams, we've got some East of Scotland teams, we've had some West of Scotland teams, and some South of Scotland teams all involved. We're going to start with East Dillonshire beating Fort William 3-0 at East Dillonshire.
Yeah, it was to be fair, it was expected. If you look at that sort of fixture, you would expect Shire to overcome them, and they did. It did take them a wee while, though. Hamilton opened the scoring pretty much late into the first half, just before the halftime whistle. Then they got a second through Tyler Fulton on the 53rd minute, and they rounded off the scoring on the 70th minute. Kevin Turner made it free. He did have to go off injured a wee bit later in the game, so hopefully he's okay. But kind of standard, really, what we would expect from Shire. I think one of the talking points is really the Fort William fans. They got a lot of credit for taking a decent support there, being boisterous for the game. Considering, obviously, you know, we've heard that the issues they've had with their home ground, it's great to see that the fans are there backing the lads, despite the result. But, yeah, kind of expected it, as I mentioned. But, Shire through to the next round.
I would just hope they get a decent payday out of that as well, because obviously they'll get the split gate, won't they? Given they've getting their home games with what's happened this year, they need every penny. So obviously we wish them all the best as a club, because regardless of their record or whatever people think about them, they're good people there behind the scenes, and fingers crossed they can keep going.
And they're one of those teams you've got to think about when you think of the Scottish Cup as well. Like, remember back in the day when you'd watch the video printer come through to see all the results. And Fort William was always a team you'd notice, I think, Wickwood and all, and I always remember Forest Mechanics, I think, and all of these teams.
And Inverary Locals, all the good names.
That's the guys, you remember them well. So, hopefully they do well at that match. But fair play to Shire. As I said, we expected it to be a win for them. They've done the job, and they've got Bonnyrigg, I think, in the next round, is it?
Yeah.
Doesn't it get easier?
It's one of those, isn't it? It must be sicker when you get a draw. You've got all these different teams with different leagues, and you end up drawing like a team in your own league. That must be absolutely devastating for you want a good cup away day, but nah, it's not to happen. Anyway, moving on to the next game, it was Broomhill versus Glasgow Uni, and it was a 6-0 win for the Broomhill boys.
Pretty good team. There's not too much to say other than Uni kind of kept it tight enough for the first half hour or so, but when we took the lead and we kind of took over the game, ultimately they got tired towards the end and we took advantage. If anyone's seen the goals through the Scottish Cup YouTube, or when it's been shared out on Twitter, you'll see a few of them were just scrappy towards the end with Uni defenders that were just shattered, to be honest. But a pretty routine win for us. We did the job professionally. We're beginning to slowly but surely find our best first 11, I feel like, as well. Gorms is beginning to settle on the boys he can rely on. Scotty Cusick getting a brace is one of them. Ross Kavanagh, one of the more recent arrivals, is another who came off the bench to great effect. So all positive from our side. Pretty tough draw in the next round, though, so we'll see how that goes. Get Trinent coming up, so that'll be an interesting yardstick on how good they are this season.
Yeah, I really like Scotty Cusick. He's a player that I've... He's always... I wouldn't say when you look at a sort of team like Broomhill, there is a few standouts, but he's one that's always seems to be in the forefront for me when I'm watching a Broomhill game, thanks to you, Mozza, on your streams. But I mean, Ross Gavanagh is different, though. I mean, he's not good enough, to be honest. I'm only kidding. I won't fish there, but yeah. But yeah, back in the past, obviously, not good enough for the level, as certain people said. But I actually like Ross as well. I've always rated him. So it's good to see him up there in terms of goal scored as well. And I think he can play pretty much up front and on both wings. So a wee bit of versatility. But yeah, not favoured by some people back in the day. So
yeah, it's funny how these comments never get forgotten, isn't it, in the Mr. Time?
Talking about comments that get forgotten, I see on Twitter you had a bit of a spat, shall we say, with someone in the DMs before the game.
It wasn't even a spat, they just went at it in the DMs, no getting a reply, and kept going and going and doubling down and tripling down. And to be fair, the boy, he did subsequently get in touch and say, look, I was a bit pished, sorry. So he also get called out and thought, yeah, okay, maybe I shouldn't have done that. But I didn't get that, why you just DM abuse to a football club of all things. Like, it just doesn't make any sense to me. But it gave us something exciting to look at as a as a post-mortem went through it, you know.
Was he a Glasgow Uni fan or something? Was he like?
I believe he's a graduate.
Right. Okay.
He was after number two. Who was number two? I'm sure he said mentioned that, like, tell number two they were awful or whatever it was.
It was let me just confirm, we number two was a man with a hat trick assist, Ryan Cinnamon, the captain. So he probably chose the wrong target, to be honest. Ryan's been great for us as captain, but the other man that I was going to mention to give a kind of special heads up to is Louis Crawford. I think he's been outstanding. He's played just about every game. And like, one of our biggest losses over the summer was losing Jammer McCormack to Bowness, and Crawford stepped in and we've no missed a beat. On the right side, he played left back against Uni and again was fantastic. So he's another one to keep an eye on.
Right, the next game then is an all-lowland league clash between the Spartans and Gala Ferdinand Rovers, and it was a 1-0 win for Gala. Now, before we start, I just need to call out the bookies here. Another two games in Skybet where they totally priced this absolutely wrong. I think they had Gala
Don't call them
don't
out.
Tell them that.
Say yeah. Thank you.
No, they are stupid. It's just stupid. It's ridiculous. Just
take the money.
Nah. I did. the Gala one and the University of Stirling prices were absolutely atrocious. I don't know who was pricing that, but they need sacked, by the way. That's the fact. Yeah, they got it so wrong. But yeah, one for Gala, 1-0 away to Spartans.
It was a bit of a shocker, actually. I think I read somewhere, I didn't watch the game, obviously, but I did read somewhere that Spartans didn't even have a shot on target, which is very surprising. They've had issues, obviously, in the sort of goalkeeping front. They had an under-20 play against East Kilbride. I'm not sure what's happening with their sort of backup keeper, because I don't think he's played this season. I know Blair Carswell's been a wee bit injured. He's had his injury issues last season, but I think coming off the Stirlingshire game, he's picked up something. They did get a boy on loan called Jack Newman from Dundee United, another boy coming in from Dundee United. So I think he was quite impressive from what I've heard. But to be honest, I think this game was, from what I've heard, mostly Gala. And Daryl Healy getting a late winner, fairly deserved from what I've heard. Gala, really impressive. And it's one of those ones, again, where we've kind of found it hard to sort of sum up Gala, if they're going to be as good as they were last season, blah, blah, blah. But it looks like they're certainly stringing together a few decent results, and obviously the cup completely different. But they'll be happy to get through to the next round.
Yeah, a cracking result. I think it's probably more worrying for Spartans, though. I would argue that home game, getting a shot on target, big Scottish Cup game, a run's obviously important for clubs at this level financially. It's not ideal, is it? But got to say, fair play to Gala for especially doing it right to the death as well.
All right, then, moving on then, it's a West of Scotland team in their first game in the Scottish Cup in 20 years at Clydebank. We're facing Dalkeith Thistle, and Clydebank dusted them 7-0. Great result for Clydebank. Obviously, know them well, and all the guys involved at Clydebank as well, so delighted for them. Obviously, they make no secret about wanting to to get progression and get back to senior football, and that's just a kind of pull of ice in the cake for them just now in terms of the result. But it's a great, great performance by all accounts, and some good goals. Very, very impressive.
Aye, and a great crowd is the other thing as well. The town really turned out to show their support when they returned to the Big Scottish, so great to see. Obviously they'll be delighted with the result, but I think they'll be even happier with the draw. A wee cheeky home draw to an SPFL side. That's a good barometer of where they are. Elgin aren't doing the best right now in League 2. I think the Bankies could well turn them over on the right day, so we'll see how that goes. But obviously when you win 7-0, there's plenty to be happy about. Dalkeith will be a wee bit upset, no doubt, but I'm delighted to see Clydebank back in it and doing well.
Yeah, I agree. I mean, you always get this feeling with Clydebank that they do have a wee bit of history, obviously, going back from the sort of previous club, and you could just tell that they were buzzing for it, and I don't know if any of you spotted Craig Holmes' celebration, but that kind of emphasised what it was like for Clydebank at the weekend. To be fair, in terms of the result, you know, I wasn't going to expect 7-0, but certainly you would expect them to maybe get past Dalkeith. But yeah, excellent. I'm really happy for the Bankies. And just one question for you, Ben. Are you feeling a wee bit slightly jealous from a kill winning point of view with the West of Scotland teams?
No, don't get me wrong. When you see the draw coming out and stuff like the last few weeks, and then you see the games kind of build up to that, and kind of the game obviously on Saturday, yeah, there's probably a little bit of that. But I mean, the way I look at it for us, it's our time will come and we'll have our own kind of our first game, and it'll be maybe the gloss will be taken away from the other teams that are playing it this year, and there'll be a new wave of teams like ourselves who will play in it next year, because I mean, for us, it's the intention is to get the license this year anyway, so it's not going to be too long before we play. And obviously, you want a nice, probably easy draw at the beginning, and then hopefully you can push on and get a run, and that's all you really want, isn't it? So we'll have a moment. That'll be the thing. I look forward to that at some point. But there was a little bit of, especially saying all the guys at Clydebank and speaking to Brockett before and stuff, and they were all kind of getting hyped up and having the BBC there and things like that to do a bit of coverage. It was cool to see. So delighted for them, absolutely delighted for them, but we'll definitely have our day at some point.
Talking of coverage, let me just talk something into existence. Bankies beat Elgin, Airdrie United next round. Yes, please.
Starting there.
Would love to see that.
Wilson was a wrestling fan, huh? He's just trying to...
What, booking ahead?
Putting grudge matches together, isn't it? It's like nostalgia matches, all put in together. That's about it. But I mean, it would be interesting to see how far Clydebank can go. I think they've got a good side, they've got good players, and they're doing well. And I mean, they're going about their business probably in the league quite quietly. They're not getting talked about too much in terms of the league and stuff like that. But a good side, and definitely the team that we'll be watching out for. We play them, I think, in 2 weeks' time, I think it is, at home park. So looking forward to going up there and seeing all the guys.
I've only just remembered they're not even Airdrie United now. They've gone back to just being Airdrie, haven't they?
Sorry, I've lost track, man.
I think they're just Airdrie Onions again, if I remember rightly.
Yeah. Fair play to Homer for his celebration, by the way. I know it was kind of... But I don't think I'd be trying that. He's a good guy, Craig. So I'm delighted for him and obviously the rest of the Bankies team. And one thing we'll probably touch on with possibly Darvel, but like you were saying about Clydebank, they've also got a lot of depth in that squad as well. So injuries less issue. So teams that I reckon have a wee bit more depth tend to do a wee bit better in cup competitions, because they have maybe under 20s that can come in, or more of the sort of experienced lads that are wanting games. So I hope they do well. Tough one against Elgin, but realistically, we'll probably get into it, but I think they can maybe have a cup shock, if you will, in inverted commas, because a lot of these games that people would expect maybe an SPFL side to win, they often don't, and it's no shock to really us or anyone that follows this level. So
Sky Bet will take 10-1 Clydebank if you're off on that.
Yes, please.
That shout, man. We'll take that, because that's how you kind of do these things. Anyway, next game then was Pennycook Athletic versus Trenent. It was a 3-1 victory for Trenent, both teams in the East of Scotland Premier League.
Yeah, glad for Pennycook, obviously. I'm a massive fan of them personally. But it's two teams going at it for the East of Scotland title this season. I think that the major talking point, not only that Trinan obviously beat Pennycook at home, but certainly Craig Stevenson, I noticed, former Pennycook, got a wee bit of stick for his celebration when he put away his penalty. I mean, I like Grinchy, but yeah, I think we kind of talked about it sort of before this podcast, but it's too much being made about former players, you know, scoring against your former team. I know, obviously, it's a wee bit of back and forth on the day if it's a former player, but I haven't raised too many eyebrows. I'm getting a wee bit of, I'm scoring a goal and being happy, but I don't think he gets too many. You know, playing it, I think he's right or left back this season. I think he's playing it on the right, actually. But yeah, he doesn't get too many, and I think he is the usual penalty scorer, so he's going to be delighted with getting a goal, I would imagine.
We said this before we started recording. I'm all for guys celebrating against their old teams. If you score a goal, why not? You know?
Yeah.
Pennycook had their wee day in the sun, to be fair, last season. They beat Steny and so on, so fair enough, give Trinan their chance if they can beat us, and then they can go on and get a big draw and go from there. I don't think Cookie will be too disappointed, given they've got the league, obviously, to concentrate on. So, it could have gone either way, to be fair.
Talking about players, I've been more with Jesse Lingard. He's on for lack of, he was getting a bit of stick from his own teammates, I think, for not celebrating
was,
Saturday.
He was, aye. Cristiano was not a fan of that.
next game then is Fraser Brat. We're playing Socky. Obviously, Socky from the East against Fraser Brat, a Highland League team. This is probably the biggest cup shock, would we say? It's a surprise for to Socky. They got a win 2-1 away to Fraser Brat. So fair play to the Socky. They were, I think, down. They got a man sent off as well, so they were kind of down to 10 men for quite a bit as well.
Yeah, they were down 1-0 with a man sent off. The keeper saved the penalty. They came back in it to win 2-1. I mean, for me, that's got to be the result of the day. It's the only fixture that I sort of looked at and went, wow, that's an amazing result. Socky they've got a wee bit of a habit of becoming a kind of, dare I say, a cup team, where they can sort of get past teams that you wouldn't really expect them to beat, and then they've shown and proved it. They've beaten the team that many expect to go on and win the Highland League this season. They're top at the moment. A team that a lot of people rate. I mean, I think my knowledge of the Highland League has gone up a wee bit thanks to guys like Niall and whatnot, yeah. And they really fancy Fraser Brat to go on and win it this year. You know, obviously Breakin and Brora still up there as well. But yeah, that fantastic result. Full credit to Socky and full credit for the manner that they went on and done it, because it's not going to be easy with 10 men. And they've managed to go out and score 2 goals and get the win, and they're through to the next round.
I mean, Fraser Brat taught Breakin a lesson just a couple of weeks ago, so that gives you an idea their level. But Socky's a really good club with good folk there behind it. We know Matty really well, obviously does their socials and such like, so I'm delighted for them. Great result, and as you say, Chris, it's the one that really jumped out afterwards, and we thought nobody called that. Everyone just assumed it was going to be a home win, because obviously the travel's the other thing when you think about it. Like, yep. They've travelled all that way up on the day, they've had adversity, they've gone down to 10, they've saved a pen, and they've somehow pulled the result out of the bag when they might have been all right with a draw and a replay. So brilliant. Fair play to them.
What? One thing we never checked, Ben, we should have checked the odds for that game. That would have been surely a decent point as well.
See, the thing was about the odds, Skybet only did like 5 or 6 games, and they got them pretty badly wrong, I think, was the thing. So anyway, I'm going to keep digging into Skybet all day. I'm
going to stop doing it. We want to win more money off them.
I think they'll have realised when I scooped a wee bit, man, off them, and a few folk I know did. So, toes up to them.
See, anyway, when you said Socky were a cup team, Chris, do you remember them beating Kilwinnie?
I was hoping that Ben was going to bring that up, but I think he's just avoided it.
He's just moved on.
I'm just going to point out the fact that we've made it through past the first round of a cup this year.
You have? Yeah.
Let me just point that out. So, Challenge Cup, second round, we made it through. So, there's an improvement on last season already. fair play. Yeah, no, as Mozza said, good people, and obviously we played them last season and got put out of the cup, and I've kind of kept in touch with Matty as well, so I'm glad for them. So obviously they'll get, I don't know, who did they get in the next round? I missed their draw, did they?
We can get to that later, I suppose.
That's fine. Next game then we're going to pick out is Arvin Meadow 1, talking like Talbot 3. I'm going to hand over you guys, because if I say anything, people will just twist my words and say that I've said something completely different. So I'll leave it to you boys.
So before we started, Ben said, get it right up the middle.
I mean, no, I didn't, but the message is fine. I mean, I'm okay with that one.
No, joking aside, Talbot do what they do just now. They go behind, they kind of struggle through, get a rocket up the backside, and they come through and get a win. It's just their MO just now. And Big Andy Leishman, who we had on loan last year and our former guys as BSE, was again outstanding, made a few brilliant saves. If anyone hasn't seen the highlights, go and watch them, because you're not going to see a better non-league keeping performance anywhere this year. But Talbot would have been justifiably favourites before it. They've done it in the end. Meda did give them a bit of a fright, though.
It's one thing coming up against a team like Talbot, but when you've got a keeper like Andy Leishman, like, some of the saves were just unreal. Like, there was one where he was, like, almost at full stretch to save it. You can see it in the highlights, but I was just amazed how well... I don't want to make out, like, he kept them in it, but certainly...
Oh, no, he did keep them in it.
Yeah, I think up until the point where Talbot really got going in the second half, you know, you're looking at Leishman, and hopefully he got man of the match. I didn't spy who got man of the match, but yeah, Talbot are a quality side. They've got a fair bit of depth. We kind of expect them to potentially be up there in terms of West of Scotland teams. I think they're top at the moment, aren't they, Ben? So, yeah, I mean, they'll want a cup run if it's going to be the Scottish Cup or the Scottish Junior Cup, which I think they're still in as well. So, aye, kind of what you expected. You do feel a wee bit, well, maybe Ben doesn't, but you do feel a wee bit for Meda, obviously, coming up against, you know, Andy Leishman having a world day on the day. I mean, there's so many times where the keeper makes a big difference, and he has done so this weekend. So
I think the thing about Auchinleck is that they've got such depth in the squad, it's ridiculous. I mean, on Saturday they had, I think, Graham Wilson on the bench, they had Mark Shankland on the bench. I mean, those guys to come on, the week before they brought on, I think, Brian Boylan and Mark Shankland and won the game. And it's having that depth in your squad. And they've also got a good side throughout the team, but obviously on Saturday they've started poorly. Andy Leishman's kept them in into half-time, only been 1-0 down, and then they come back out and do their thing. And that's why they are where they are in terms of all the competitions they play in, and that's why they're successful, because they every year, and I think for me, being selfish, I'm glad they're still in and they're playing as many competitions as they can, because they'll get to a point where they're probably playing about three games a week when it comes to the crunch of the season. And I know we maybe haven't started, we haven't kind of continued our form from the start of the season, but it's good for any team at the top of the league if Talbot are playing as many games as possible, because yes, they have the depth, but it will take its toll eventually. I think we've obviously seen a lot from, like Sandarvo mentioned, they've got some squad issues at the moment, and Talbot, I think, have been quite fortunate on that front as well, that they're not having to kind of use the squad because the guys are all fit and they're doing quite well. But yeah, fair play to them. I'm not going to say much about them. I don't really need to say anything about them. Everyone knows my feelings about them, so I don't want to get into that and get myself into any more trouble. So we'll dust over that. I just hope that the fans all behaved. That's all I'm going to say on that matter. But moving on then to the rest of the draw, we'll just kind of quick run through of some of the results that happened in the competition. So Wigtown Bladdock
scores,
exactly. Wigtown Bladdock were defeated off St Cuthbert's Wanderers 8-0.
By the way, just before we go into the rest of the games, see how we just said the best non-league goalkeeper for performance? If you watch those Wigtown highlights, you might see the possibly the worst a candidate for it anyway. The boy had a mare, unfortunately.
To be fair, all south of Scotland tie as well, but you would expect St Cuthbert's, probably between them three going for south of Scotland this season. St Cuthbert's, I actually rate their team, so it'll be interesting. For me, it's actually good to see a South of Scotland team get to the second round as well. So I'm quite happy for them in that sense. But would they have needed a Wigtown to get there? I think that's probably one of their better ties that they could have had. So it'll be interesting to see if they can get through the next round.
Other game is Coldstream 1, East Kilbride 10. I mean, probably comfortable performances for what we expected. But again, probably didn't expect 10, did we, boys?
Maybe no 10, but yeah, Coldstream have struggled a wee bit there.
East Kilbride have sort of, I think a boy called Jack Stainrods came on. He was like a youth at Sheffield United or something. So I don't know. That's one of the most weirdest transfers. But Cammy Elliott's done really well. But the thing that I spotted was the fact that Lee Miller and Chris Miller both started. I don't know where they've been the last sort of 2 months. I think that might be their first start for East Kilbride. I might be wrong about that, but certainly the first time I've noticed them in the starting lineup. So good game to come into. We'll just have to sort of see how it sort of progresses into the league for East Kilbride.
Next one was on my mother, they mentioned briefly, it was Cali Braves, now University of Stirling 1. Thanks to Sky Bet for this one.
13-2
13-2 absolutely ridiculous.
Nonsense.
Price.
Absolute nonsense price.
Madness. I don't know where they, I think you know where they got that from. Like, to me, it was probably like maybe a 2-1 dog, maybe at the time, given it was an away game.
I mean, I expected them to maybe go 5-2 max when you're looking at it that way. But we talked about it beforehand. It was, we couldn't resist that price, could we? Even if Uni of Stirling hadn't won it, on the odds, you had to have a nibble at it.
Slightly wishing I was a betting man, but I think the person that maybe put that together was looking at the result in the league, because Cali Braves and Finistone did beat Stirling Uni 4-1, but if you know the level, obviously it's a different case. You're like, that's probably going to be an even game. Both teams kind of like the cup. Obviously, Mark Adams from Stirling Uni loves the cup, as it's been stated all week. So I actually watched the game. I was quite disappointed with the performance. I don't think, the way I look at it, if you don't have the energy to get up for the Scottish Cup, then like there's no hope for you. But to be fair to Stirling, they took their chance. I think they could have killed off the game. The energy levels, I didn't think they were great from both teams. It was just really a spell. And I think Cali Braves, in fairness to them, sort of second half, they could have actually got the replay. It's one of those ones where I think the defending was probably better than the attacking. And that, for me, that's disappointing. There's been a lot of really subpar games this season that I've seen. And I don't know if it's a result of guys not playing for as long as they have, but compared to a few seasons ago, there has been a lot of sort of strange games, strange results, and subpar performances. And I don't want to be overly critical, because obviously Stirling Uni will be delighted to get through, but yeah, it was very strange, very strange. The defence won the day for Stirling Uni, for me.
Good result for Uni. It's good to see them progressing as well through the cup. I mean, that's the thing for all these teams, isn't it? You really want to see them get a wee run. So hopefully Uni can push on and do a bit of damage, maybe get themselves a bigger draw in there, if they can get through the second round. Next one then, Lossiemouth 0, Preston Athletic 3. My mate was running the line at this game, so he was from one of my work colleagues was running the line. So don't know much about the game, I haven't spoken to him, but seems a comfortable win for Preston.
Brilliant result. Another one that's hard on the Highland teams, I would say.
I mean, Lossie aren't great this year, to be honest. You kind of had a suspicion this was coming, but don't take away from Preston, they've been a Highland league team.
Absolutely, yeah. Next one then, Dumbarton United 2, Camelin 0. An all East of Scotland tie, is that?
Yeah.
I was a wee bit surprised with this. Camelin have been doing all right, but Dunbar's reward is they're playing the winners for tonight, aren't they, for Berwick and Gretna? So that'll be an interesting game, regardless of which one gets through.
Camelin are a strange one, because obviously they've lost a lot of the squad they had last season. They've been kind of sort of bringing in more players I've noticed recently to sort of strengthen up their squad. They have probably done a wee bit better than I thought they would so far in the league. But if you look at the East of Scotland this season, there's so many decent teams. Like, the qualities went up massively again. I mean, you look at who the likes of Donald have brought in. Crossgate's Primrose doing really well. I mean, I've kind of favoured Fife teams there, but obviously I'm a Fifer. So the Greg Spence playing for Hillfield Swifts are just unreal. So East of Scotland's a very exciting league this season, and I don't think any result would surprise me either way, from the bottom to the top.
Next game then, Brechin versus Vale Leithen. It was a Highland versus Lonely team. It's a 5-0 win for Brechin. Probably what we expected to happen. We know all about Vale, but fair play to Brechin. I think it was a easy work for them.
Letting the team down, Vale.
I mean, to be fair to Vale, I think they actually played as well as they could do with the personnel they've got. Brechin missed a few chances as well, make it more, but that was probably the banker of the weekend, I'd suggest.
The strangest signing, actually, Brechin signed Cammy Ross from Broxburn recently, which is really weird because he's based in Edinburgh. So fantastic signing for them. I think Broxburn will miss him. But Brechin, I think they've made a lot of decent signings, and I think they will be challenging for the Highland League. They definitely seem like there's been a whole revamp since relegation. So interesting one to keep an eye on, Brechin.
Next one then, Inverurie Locos, now Genefield Swifts 3, and a good result for another Easter Scotland team.
Yeah, and I heard there was a good crowd there as well, which is good to see. There was a lot of the Perth contingent up following Genefield. The next round, I believe, falls on a weekend where St Johnstone are away at Rangers and there's no away fans allowed. So the suggestion is there could be a big away following again going for their next cup game, which again would be great for them.
Yeah, I mean, I like what Genefield have done over the last sort of few years. A lot of their squad's very locally based around Perth. They're very much a represent the community of Perth team sort of thing. And you kind of do get that with most teams, but in terms of players, players are usually all around the country. But for Genefield, it's different. It's like most of the boys there were either born or live in Perth, so it's definitely a sort of community feel. St Johnstone, obviously, very supportive of them as well. The only thing I would say, I mean, it's apart from it being a fantastic result, did you see their kit, like fluorescent yellow? So that must have been a distraction, surely. It's like I don't know if you remember the Barca kit from a few years ago where it was like their third kit where it was just like fluorescent yellow.
Neon, basically,
yeah. So that must have helped them, because playing against that, you would get surely distracted.
Dazzled.
Next game then is Keith 1, Darvel 2, West Scotland team being a Highland team. I mean, close result, I think. Darvel probably were going up there thinking they're going to absolutely dust them, but it's a progression in the competition for them.
Win's the main thing, but I'm surprised it was only 2-1, because Keith are a bit of a basket case at the minute, just struggling along. And you'd think with the investment, obviously they've got injury issues at Darvel, but you'd still think overall they'd have enough to see them away. But they've given them a good game there, of Keith, so fair play to them.
I don't know how to judge this, because we do know that Darvel are a decent side. They've invested quite heavily. But what I would say is a lot of people basically go on, oh, well, maybe guys aren't used to the travel, but I know you've got comments to make on that, Ben, but surely some of the boys that have came down, even if you look at the Lone League, obviously there's guys, oh, well, you're not used to the travel. It's like, well, you're going to places like Berwick and Dalbeattie and whatever else. But the one takeaway I would say, Darvel are a wee bit struggling in the league. It's not been a great start for them overall, but they do have a severe amount of injuries to some of their top players. So it's difficult to judge them and whether they have so far underperformed because of all the sort of mitigating circumstances. But I'm eager to hear from you, Ben, and what you want to say.
Yeah, so Mark, as you mentioned travel there, Chris, I believe Ben's got some input.
Yeah, so I really like the whole Darvel story, right? I'm a big fan of it. It adds a little bit of spice to the West of Scotland League, the whole money thing. And if you talk to people from that who are involved at Darvel, they make out like the money thing isn't that big a deal, right? Now, if you had any other team in the West of Scotland that were travelling up north to play in the Scottish Cup, there's no chance that any team is staying in a hotel the night before their first Scottish Cup game, right? Now, they get a wee bit upset when people mention the money and all that kind of stuff. Now, that screams to me like you've got plenty of money if you're spending the whole night before for the full squad, by all accounts, bus up to the hotel and staying overnight. I just think they should own the whole money thing and just accept, like, just own it rather than like try to make out that it's not something that it is. We all know what the stories are about money, and I mean, I've heard some absolutely crazy claims. I mean, I was at a game on the bus game the other week, and somebody claimed that the boy Craig Moore was on £1,500 a week, right? That's just fantasy stuff, right? That's not the case, right? We all know that, right? That's not going to be the case. The boys have like a ball of anger, I think he's been in, but for me, you just need to own the money thing. If you're spending money, it's fine. My team has done it before in the West of Scotland or in the juniors before. It's not a new thing to spend money on your playing budget. And they've done a lot of stuff in terms of the infrastructure. Apparently, by all accounts, the pitch is incredible. At Darvel, which is meant to be one of the best surfaces in Scotland. And they've obviously got a licence now as well. So I just need to think to myself, either own it or don't be so show off about your money when you're booking hotels up in Aberdeen. Because I bet there wasn't a wee shitey Premier Inn was then, better than a right good spa hotel or something with a pool and a gym and all that kind of stuff and nice meals and all that before it. So it wouldn't have been cheap. So I just feel like if you're going to take umbrage to the fact that people are slapping you for spending money, don't be booking hotels, man. That's just ridiculous.
Kelly, to be fair, done it before.
Kelly is exactly, yeah.
Yeah, done before the playoff, quite higher stakes than...
Different game, man.
Yeah, quite higher
but
stakes.
Kelly's another team that struggles to kind of reason with the whole, they've got a wee bit more money behind them type angle. And I think you're right, Ben, why not? Just put, well... We're in a fortunate position, aren't we?
Yeah, to be fair, it got to the stage with Kelty, I think, where it was kind of all hush-hush before, and then they kind of just went, to hell with it, people know about it, look at who we're signing, and then it became like, ah, they're buying us half with, goal bonuses are like fucking £300 each or whatever, you know, but...
conservatories for hat-tricks.
So I think you're right, Ben. I think if you start owning that, then people, you can have a laugh with it. I mean, money, it's a strange one because if it's so obvious in football, the teams that have money, because they spend it. It's not usually like a hush-hush thing where like, we've got 20 grand or whatever to spend. I mean, 20 grand's nothing anyway to most teams. I think I've said this to you guys before, but the fact that some people say like, oh, there's no money in Scottish football, it's a complete myth. I mean, even to pay a team of like 18, 19 or whatever, 100 quid a week, you still need about 90 grand to run it. So, yeah, it's a complete myth that these clubs are skint usually.
It's nothing new to like this level of football. This is the thing I always think about. It's been done before. Huddersfield done it, Pollock done it, Kilwarren done it 20 years ago, Auchinleck have done it. I mean, it's not a new thing. So just accept it. I think what happens is you go in the defensive a lot of the time, and I know I like Mick, I'm a big fan of Mick, but he's always on Pie and Bovril, and he's on full name on Pie and Bovril and giving. I was like, that's another thing, just fucking leave those guys alone. That place is an absolute cesspit. It's like
we've learned the hard way as well, like just to ignore them, eh?
Yeah, the guy comes, I mean, fair play, I mean, comes on, his username is Mick Kennedy on Pie and Bovril, and he comes on and tries to dispel a lot of the rumour and things that are mentioned, but just going back to the travel, I mean, don't be showing off your booking hotels up to Aberdeen the night before your Scottish Cup match, because that's just showing you've got plenty, though, put it that way.
As the kids would say, it's a bit of a flex.
It is, absolutely is, and it probably wasn't meant from I know Mick put up on Twitter, and it probably wasn't meaning it in that way, but it just came across a bit like, aye, we've got hundreds of money, and we're booking hotels, and we're having nice meals and all that before the match.
Just think about Albion Rovers and their trip to Brora they've got to do. Poor Albion.
Albion Rovers, man.
Their packed lunch with their sannies.
Where's the nearest campsite, lads? Get the tent, so you know what I mean. So,
Albion Rovers is a team.
Memories.
Just when you mentioned him, I read an article the other day from Ross Stewart, that used to play for Cowan now at Sunderland, and he was complaining about the fact that Buffs wouldn't release him to, I think it was to Queen's Park, then Albion Rovers potentially. And I was like, why is the story about us not releasing them? I thought to myself, wait a minute, it's because Albion Rovers were tight as fuck. It's not our fault.
Uh-huh.
Like, and that's notorious, Albion Rovers. You see their managers putting articles up saying, oh, we've avoided a trip up north because it's going to cost us too much money. It just
they were celebrating that Brora didn't win the playoff. That was the story, wasn't it? Because they were scared how much the bus was going to cost or something. Just
that's as tin pot as you'll get.
As tin pot, part of being in a national league is you accept that. So...
But Albion Rovers, I have these favourite Albion Rovers. Then next game, then we're going to move on to Civil Service Strollers defeated Goldsby Sutherland 3-0.
And that was a hell of an away trip. Talking of away trips, fair play Civil. They've gone. I'm pretty sure that would have been the furthest journey, or one of the furthest journeys of the round. I saw them put a couple of graphics up on their Twitter about it anyway, showing the distance. But professional job, beat Goldsby, they've only played one league game so far, if I remember rightly, in the North Cali. So they're not exactly be too sharp, I wouldn't think, at this point, but still got to go and do the business, and I've done it.
Kyle Fee's defending. What a guy. I don't know if you see
That picture.
Matt
Hancock kind of wincing away for the ball vibes.
That's what I like about Kyle. He's quite open about some of his defending at times. Probably the most honest player I've seen in the Lone League, and we really appreciate Kyle for that. I thought that picture he put up was quite funny. To me, it was like a health and safety guy. Say if you came off like a rider saying and just helping you down. It looked a wee bit like that. But nah, fair play to Civil. You kind of, it's one of those that you probably would expect them to win that as well. So, but easier said than done, and they've done the business there, and they're through to the next round.
Next game then, Wick Academy 2, Bo'ness United 2, and that'll be a long trip for Wick to play that replay.
And they'll travel. When they were playing, was it Stirling they played a year or two back? They travel really well, considering where they're from. So I think Bo'ness will take that in the replay, to be honest.
I mean, Mick Kennedy's got a hotel contact if you need it. sorting you out.
I've actually made a mistake there, lads, and that's meant to be on the next sort of stage of replays. I must have just forgot to remove that fixture, but it's fine. Anyone listening, yeah, mistake there for me.
And then, as my teammate mentioned, a well-known Scottish Cup team, Forest Mechanics, now everybody's favourite, Bonnyrigg Rose too.
Good result. Yeah. And I'm sure a lot of Rose fans have been full of praise for Forest as well, for the fans, and it seems like they had a great time. Just a cracking cup atmosphere, so that was good to see as well.
And I think Bonnyrigg mentioned it as well, but I'm sure they had a fair bit of travelling support as well, which is always good to see, especially for teams at this level.
Next one then is Devon Vale 2, Haddington Athletic 2.
Another one. I've not removed these cup replays, but yeah, fantastic draw for Haddington, to be honest. I mean, another one that you were, what, Highland versus East of Scotland. That was a shock.
Well, bear in mind, they beat us in the cup last year and played very well, in fairness. So maybe not as much a surprise as you think. Devon Vale, again, are a beatable Highland side. No disrespect to them, but I kind of fancy Haddington to get through that in the replay, I'll be honest.
Yep, I would agree.
Yeah, at home, they've got a good chance. As you say, they do well in the cup, so hopefully they can get through and get in the next round. Next one then, Clannacon 1, Dunne Pace 2, East of Scotland team beating a Highland League team again.
Brilliant result for Dunne. Brilliant result.
Dunne Pace are, to be fair, we talk about quality again. They're a East of Scotland conference side at the moment. I expect them to be in the Premier next season, but you're talking about what, a tier 7 side, but now a tier 5 side. But we've seen these results before, obviously. Don't mention the recent cup final, but Dunne Pace are obviously a quality side that probably could be playing at least one or two tiers up from where they are. So
at least a tier high.
Yeah,
but you look at some of the players they've got, like they've got Grant up front who could easily be playing lowland level. Just a really intelligent striker. They're just a good team, and they seem to have a great team kind of ethic as well. They're always putting up pictures of the bus journeys and that. So. They've got a great kind of dressing room atmosphere there.
And just to point out, a really nice ground as well. I don't know if you guys have been to Dunne Pace, but
cracking me ground.
It's a strange one just with the levels, but I quite like being up in the sort of, I guess you would call it the hill to watch games. But really nice there up at Dunne Pace as well. And they've obviously got a wee bit of previous where being in the where they were once in the West Juniors, weren't they, Ben? So. It's kind of weird that they're West and East previously, but yeah, good result.
And the final game that was a win for Brora, they defeated Tynecastle 6-0.
Feels like Brora are kind of getting back to what they are normally now, doesn't it? After a pretty shaky start, losing their gaffer, maybe settled down a wee bit now. Unfortunately for Tynecastle, they've played them a wee bit too late in the season. I'd suggest that, again, it's one we kind of thought would happen.
Yeah, with no offence to Tynecastle, they're obviously a lot of the guys are a lot younger, probably not got the experience of a Scottish Cup. Some of the players will, but not a not a result they would have wanted, but probably expected in terms of them them not progressing.
Okay, so some of the matches went to well, draws, and we'll go to replays to be played next Saturday. You've got Bowness United, obviously, versus what we mentioned earlier. Bucky Thistle versus Cumbernauld Colts, a draw for Cumbernauld. I guess would be a decent result again, playing a Highland League team.
Brilliant free kick from Craig Murray. I think they'll be gutted that they never saw that off at home. It actually makes it a lot tougher for them to go and then travel up. But I'm still quietly confident that they'll get through that one, Cumbernauld.
Yeah, next game then, Cumnock versus Fullmartin United. Cumnock apparently taking 1,000 up to Fullmartin by all accounts on Pine Burville, but I think that was grossly exaggerated by the some random punter on Pine Burville. But again, probably a decent result for Cumnock. Come back to get another tie and play at home against Fullmartin next Saturday. So Cumnock have been playing well. We played them a few weeks back. Good individual players, 2 centre-halves are pretty strong as well. But yeah, it'll be interesting to see how this match, obviously, for Martin having to travel down next Saturday. I mean, they'll not be staying at Mick Kendi's hotel next Saturday, so they'll be on the bus journey down in time for the warm up, I'm sure. But interesting to see how this one plays out.
I fancy Cumnock for that, actually, just being at home. If you go through West, even if you're an East of Scotland team, the fans will get, you know this yourself, obviously Ben being involved with Kill winning, but there's a lot, I wouldn't say there's a lot more fans, but they're more boisterous fans and getting behind their team sort of thing that you don't necessarily see with some clubs in the Lone League or the East of Scotland. So that's definitely a factor that plays into these games.
I saw the Astro at Cumnock and they'll have their home crowd, as you say, Chris, so I'd expect Cumnock to get the result and get through to the next round. Next one then, Dalbeattie Star versus Newton Green Stabs. Also a draw, the Battle of the Stars. There we go, lads. There's the social media people at Dalbeattie and Newton Green. You can have that one for free.
Someone had already took that idea. I think there was a picture of Yoda or something. I'm pretty sure George Lucas is going to sue him. Star Wars. But great result to draw. Newton Green Star, I think, are another team that I actually expect them to do a wee bit better in terms of where they are in the league. But a lot of changes recently, similar to like Sahilla Beef maybe. But yeah, fantastic draw at the end of the day, taking that to replay. But I do think Dalbeattie will fancy their chances, especially at the Hillcroft.
Next game then, Edinburgh Uni versus Lothian Thistle. Hutchison Vale, and as Chris just tells me there, that's one team, not two teams. I was thinking that was some sort of preliminary round match that still had to be played or something. So obviously we know Edinburgh Uni pretty well. And I think we probably look at maybe this could be a game where the lower tier side can probably get through here, Chris.
Yeah, the Edinburgh Uni, because they played yesterday at Ainslie Park, because that's where Lothian Thistle are playing nowadays for this season. But I think Edinburgh Uni, from what I've heard, were a wee bit in charge of that game until Lothian Thistle really just came back and got back into it. I've seen Lothian Thistle recently. They're a really decent outfit in East of Scotland. I've seen Edinburgh Uni recently, really impressed with them as well. I think it's going to be a tough game. I think we're probably going to see a similar sort of close scoreline. It was 2-2 yesterday, so I could see that one potentially. I think, if I remember correctly, it doesn't go to extra time. I think it will go straight to penalties. So yeah, so I think that may be one that goes to pens. Like, I'm not going to lie.
We've got Derek, but I think he's disappeared, maybe having some sort of connection problem, perhaps. But we'll move on. The final game then is Haddington Athletic versus Devon Vale. We've already mentioned them. Yep. It's probably a chance for Haddington to get through. Okay, final game then, we haven't touched on, is the game that's happening tonight between Bennett Rangers and Gretna 2008. I think we'll leave live on BBC Scotland, is it?
I'm looking forward to it. I would probably favour Berwick over Gretna. Obviously, Gretna are still looking for a manager. Eddie Warwick, the sort of head of youth development, first team coaches in charge at the moment. They have made... the funny thing about Gretna is they've not actually played in a few weeks for whatever reason, but they have made a few changes to the squads, bringing in quite a few sort of defenders, which will be interesting, obviously, to see how they do today. But it's not one easy to predict, because they have brought in a fair few players over the last couple of weeks. So that will be tough to see how they gel. But I still would sort of favour Berwick. I think Berwick have probably a wee bit more about them in terms of experience and whatnot compared to Gretna tonight.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to this one. As I say, I've not had a lot of chance to see many of the Lowland League teams live this year, because obviously I'm involved at Quinn and our games kick off at 2 the time you get home and stuff. It's pretty much full time in these matches. So looking forward to sit down and watching Berwick versus Gretna. It'll be good to see. Obviously, there was a lot of talk about which game should be on, and I think obviously we'd have probably thought that Irvine Meadow versus Auchinleck would have been the tie on the TV, but I don't think they quite fancy the Monday night at Meadow Park, rather than kind of missing out on the Saturday kind of gate and things like that. So it'll be interesting to watch Berwick and Gretna tonight. So
I actually agree. I think there was probably more sort of favourable ties that could have been on TV, but I think the difference with Berwick and Gretna, there's probably a wee bit of a narrative there for BBC. Obviously, Berwick used to be in the SPFL. Yep. Gretna, you know, coming from the Phoenix Club, basically, of the original Gretna. So I think there is a narrative there, which is obviously great for the TV guys. So I think what you're saying is right as well. Some teams probably don't fancy the fact that you have to change from a Saturday to a Monday or a Friday sometimes. I agree to an extent that obviously there was probably a wee bit more interesting ties compared to this one. But with no disrespect to either team, they are both sort of tier 5 sides as well, so you can kind of look at it that way also.
Yeah, I mean, that's it. I don't think there's a lot of benefit, certainly from a club perspective, to play the game on a Monday night. I don't think the payment you get from BBC is all that much, to be honest, to cover kind of the losses you have. So I can see from kind of Meadow and Talbot's perspective why that game was a Saturday.
Also not this early as well. If it had been in the later rounds, obviously you're probably talking a wee bit more, but certainly first, second round, you're probably not thinking too much, really.
Exactly. So, I mean, there's probably an argument. I think if it was me co-winning, I'd probably want to be on telly, but given it was probably the first time we've ever played in the Scottish Cup, and well, not the first ever time, but the first time that we played a West Scotland versus West Scotland would have been that. And I think, obviously, you could have maybe argued for Clyde Bank as well, given the history with them, and I know they weren't maybe playing a side that maybe is exciting to watch or anything like that. But I think it was probably a case here for a West Scotland team being on the TV. But maybe we'll see what happens in the next round. Maybe there's a few times we're going to move on to the next round now, but that will probably worth being on the TV at some point, so it'll be interesting to see what happens there. Right then, moving on to the third round, as I say, we'll just quickly scoot through some of the ties. We'll start off Anne Athletic versus Genefield Swifts. Good draw for Genefield, playing a lead side there, obviously, Chris.
Anne and Athletic are really impressive this season. I think they've got a class team. I think they're at the moment second in League 2, so they're doing really well. But Genefield, again, another team that you can never sort of discount. They had, I think if I remember correctly, this is like the first time in their history they're through to the second round. So they'll be absolutely chuffed to get a tie with Annan. But it's going to be a difficult one, because I do actually rate Annan. I rate a lot of the League 2 teams better this season than previous years. I think Brechin, for example, getting relegated last season has kind of gave them a wee bit of a boot up there. The backside, if you will.
Next one then, Banks of Dee versus Nairn County. And all North of Scotland tie. We don't really know much about them. We'll probably just probably focus more on the Lowland League sides in the East and the West, obviously. So obviously next game then, Berwick Rangers and getting a play tonight. The winners of that will play Stirling Albion. Another good draw for either of those teams who can get the victory.
Another tough game as well. Stirling Albion, another team that are, I would expect to be sort of towards the top in League 2. I think I would say they're top half anyway at the moment. And again, another team that's improved. But the beauty about the Scottish Cup is you never know. There's obviously a potential for shocks. So we would hope that the SPFL teams would be getting beaten, would get beat by the non-league sides. For our point of view.
Absolutely. The next game then is Brechin City versus the winners of Devon Vale and Haddington Athletic. Got to fancy probably Brechin to beat either of those sides, you would think, Chris?
Yeah, I would agree with that. I think it's going to be tough. I do fancy Haddington to get through over Devrinville. But yeah, Brechin, they have strengthened their squad. They've probably, as I say, they've done a sort of complete rebuild since being relegated. So they're looking quite strong again, probably stronger than they were in the league, which is a bit strange to say. So it's going to be uphill for Haddington if they get through there.
Next one then, Brora Rangers versus Albion Rovers. Now, the one we just mentioned there. So Albion having to make the journey up north.
Yeah, not one that Brian Reid's gonna like, to be honest.
Start the GoFundMe now, Chris.
It's you know, it's something we've talked about, obviously, but I mean, you've got to realise that you're playing football away. You're probably going to have to travel a wee bit further field when you're in a thing like a Scottish Cup, and it's, you'd kind of maybe forgive them a wee bit if it was like a non-league side that have not been used to the Scottish Cup, but you're talking about a league side like Albion. The thing that you guys mentioned earlier, I love the fact that somewhere in Cope Bridge there was guys celebrating the fact that the Highland team never got promoted last season. So I thought that was hilarious. Like,
they must play up north at some point this season, so it's not like as if it's like it's, I'm not used to it.
Elgin, maybe? Elgin, exactly, is probably the first.
I was thinking it was just still a journey for a team from Cope Bridge, let's be honest. But pure tin pot from Albion Rovers, let's be honest. But we'll keep banging that drum until we end up in Tier 7 or something like that, Scottish football. That'll be a joyous day. They'll not have to worry about travel there when they end up in the West Scotland League. I'm not bitter, honestly. next one then, Clydebank versus Elgin City. We just mentioned that earlier on. This is a good game, I think, for me. I'm looking forward to this one. This could be the TV game, actually. I think if you look at some of the ties, there's a potential there for this to be the TV match. It's obviously local, it's BBC at Glasgow and Clydebank and stuff, and it's a West of Scotland team versus a league side. So I would quite like to see this one, hopefully maybe on the TV, maybe every Monday night, and we can all sit down and maybe have a wee watch along on Mozzie Stream or something.
I do fancy Clydebank's chances here because Elgin haven't been playing overly well, but I do still rate Elgin, so I don't think it's as, the chances are as, you know, as good as they were in the previous round, for example. So I think we have to give a wee bit of respect to Elgin. They do have some decent players. But the fact that Clydebank are at home, again, I think the fact that the fans comes into it, the whole town's going to be behind them again, it does make Elgin, who will have to travel down as well, there's a lot of advantages for Clydebank, but again, it's one that I could probably see, another shock in inverted commas for Clydebank. I really hope they get through that one, but I have to watch what I say because I do have some sort of players that I know at Elgin who I rate, so... It's a tough one, but I agree, actually. I would like to see that on the TV. I would like to see one of the, either a Auchinleck Talbot or a Clydebank on TV. I think that would be an interesting game.
I think the Clydebank game's a shout, I think, honestly. I think that's potential for Clydebank to get the match on TV. I'm just thinking, though, that Mick Kennedy can maybe start a travel agency and start at least people out with hotel command. There's a job for Mick there. Mick Kennedy, travel agents and getting hotels for
You're banging on about this week, man.
just having a good laugh about it. Sorry. There he is, he's back.
He's back. If he's dug on mental.
I think Ben purposely missed out the Broomhill game for you. So
I didn't actually. Fuck, I didn't.
I thought that's where you were going with that.
I didn't. Next game then is on his return from internet troubles or wherever he went to. Broomhill versus Tynan. Mozzie, do you fancy yourselves here?
I think it's a toss-up, to be honest. I'm happy it's a home game for us. Gives us a shot, but... It wouldn't surprise me to see either side go through, so we'll see how it goes.
I need to watch what I'm saying, actually, because obviously we've had Callum Elliott, the Tyrant manager, on previously. I think he was at Tynecastle at the time, but I think he fell out with us a wee bit because we didn't sort of fully back Tyrant being promoted last season, but we couldn't, so I don't know what the issue was there with him. So, but yeah,
he maybe just doesn't like him, mate.
And maybe that as well. There's a few people, to be fair. So, Tyrone are a decent team. Probably expect them to challenge these to Scotland, as I've mentioned. Tough game, but yeah, I can see Broomhill going through there as well.
Next one then, Cowden Beath versus Civil Service Trollers. You've probably got to say this is a chance here for a bit of a, I guess, a cup shock, if you like, again, with Civil. Civil obviously playing quite well. Cowden Beath, one of the kind of middle to bottom teams in the League Two. And yeah, I mean, I actually fancy Civil to get a result here.
Well, obviously, they're local to me, Cowden Beath, so I might get along, depending on the prices of this match. But to me, it's going to be an interesting one because Cowden Beath are currently ninth. We've talked about teams improving in League Two previously, Ben, but they're a team that I wouldn't say have overly improved. So this could be a good yardstick for, you know, the playoffs. Like a decent team, a higher up team this season in Civil Service against a League Two team that's struggling. I actually do fancy Civil to get a result there.
I could see it. I could definitely see it, especially Civil's strength is going forward, I would say. But the players have got, they're quite pacey, they should give Cowden Beath problems, ultimately. So I think they'd be happy enough with a replay, but who knows, we'll see.
And next game then, Dunbar United versus the winners of Lothian Thistle, Hutchinson Vale or Edinburgh Uni. Could be an interesting, potentially all a East of Scotland tie. I guess it's an East of Scotland tie either way with Edinburgh Uni, but if Lothian Thistle, Hutchinson Vale can get through, then you obviously got potential there for a kind of East of Scotland team being in the third round.
Just a toss up again, I think, that one.
Yeah, between all three teams, I think probably equal pegging, in my mind anyway.
Next one then, East Kilbride versus University of Stirling, an all Lowland League tie. I think we probably think that East Kilbride are going to kind of get through this one comfortably.
You think so? When they write off, you know, sort of Stirling, though, they tend to pull out results here and there, as we know. So East Kilbride favourites, but again, could quite easily see a draw or an away win there as well.
I was probably a wee bit harsh with Stirling Uni earlier, to be honest. But I think they need to do a lot more in terms of taking their chances, like they did last season. I think they need to improve on that to be taking on the likes of East Kilbride.
Next game then is East Stirlingshire versus Bonnyrigg Rose. Again, probably a close game, isn't it? All Lowland League tie. I mean, this could potentially go to a draw and then replay.
It's usually close for these two. I'm going to say an away win. I think most people would say an away win. Shire just aren't as good a team overall, I wouldn't say. But who knows?
I would disagree. I think Shire are starting to click a wee bit more. Okay. Obviously beating the likes of Spartans. You know, Fort William, obviously not the same sort of standard. But I actually think things are starting to click for East Stirlingshire. I think the game against Bonnyrigg last time was only, I think it was only a goal in it. So the home tie again, I think, helps them. But you know, Bonnyrigg are going to be bringing a big support there as well. I think you're right though. Either way, it's going to be close.
Bonnyrigg win by a set piece.
And that's typical. Yep.
What, you mean a penalty, mother?
Well, I've got a graphic ready in case it's needed.
No, sir. Not saying anything.
Edinburgh, this game at Edinburgh City versus Wick Academy or Bowness United. I'll be interested to see, obviously, if Bowness can get through. You think they probably will, we've also touched on that earlier, but could be I think Edinburgh City are obviously a good side.
Edinburgh City, the interesting thing for me is that they're going to be moving into Meadowbank soon, so I don't know if this game is going to be before or after, but I don't think Edinburgh City are as good as they were in previous seasons, but I still think they're probably better than Wick and Bowness United at the moment.
Yeah, I agree with you, they're not as good as they were last season. I still think they've got too much for those two, though. Bowness themselves haven't had a great season thus far, and I just think they're a better team than Wick. So I don't think they'll be in the new stadium. I've just given it a quick search. Doesn't look like they'll be back in, so it should still be Ainslie. But I still see Edinburgh City doing the business here.
Next one then is Fort Martin or Cumnock versus Forfar Athletic. Now, for me, I think if Cumnock can get through, this is a really good tie for them in terms of playing against a league side there at Townhead Park. So it'll be interesting to see. Obviously, got to get through the replay on Saturday, but a good draw for both sides, really, I would say.
Forfar are a strong team in League Two. I think I don't think they're quite there at the moment, but many at the start of the season would expect them to be right up there in terms of competing with Kelty. I still feel that way. I just don't think they're they've clicked right away, but we're only obviously a handful of games in, so but tough one. But again, if Cumbernauld can get the support there, and that's obviously if they get through, obviously, but you never know. That's what's good about the Scottish Cup, you never know. But I would say, obviously, on paper, Forfar are the more likely there.
Next game then, Kelly Hearts versus Cumbernauld Colts or Bucky Thistle. Kelly obviously flying at the top of a League 2. I'd imagine they would be able to beat both sides. It doesn't matter who gets through there.
Kelly haven't had a great time in the Scottish Cup, though, when you look back at it. They've never gone past this round that we're in. So you never know. That could be a wee shock in the cards, especially if they rotate with a view of the league as well. I think Bucky might give them a few issues if they get through. I do think they would beat Cumbernauld Colts. I'm just thinking Bucky in terms of their style of play. Like, Talbot gave Kelty all sorts of issues last year because it was up in their faces and playing them rough, and they didn't like it. So I think Bucky could well do that to them as well.
Colts have a bit of a record over Kelty, but it's mainly at Broadwood. Because it's at home, obviously, I would fancy Kelty there.
Next game then, Newton Green Star or Dalbeattie Star versus Rothes. Could be an interesting potential tie there for obviously the Leinster Scotland side. If obviously Dalbeattie, we think Dalbeattie will win, I'm sure, in the replay, but it will be an interesting game.
I see either Star beating Rothes, to be honest.
Yeah, I would say so, yeah. Especially with the travel. I mean, if you're Rothes, you probably want Newton Grange over Dalbeattie from one length of the country to the other. So, yeah, I do fancy whoever wins out of Newton Grange or Dalbeattie to get the one over Rothes there.
Yeah.
Next one then, Preston Athletic versus Auchinleck Talbot. We've touched on Auchinleck, obviously, plenty. I think they'll be too much for Preston myself.
Yeah, I'd agree with that. I think there'll be goals there as well. It might not be too pretty at Preston Pond.
That's it. Auchinleck Talbot, they're bomb winners, and they like the cup as well. So I think that's the main thing.
The Preston folk were really happy to get a big tie. They see that as a good tie for them to get with all the Talbot fans coming to town. So I think they're just happy to be in this round and get that tie drawn.
Talbot, yeah. Absolutely. They'll travel, man. They'll probably take 800 to maybe 1,000 potentially in the town. They'll go up in the buses and they'll be a busy docking like Talbot support. So yeah, fair play to the Preston. I mean, probably one of the better draws you could probably get. So fair play. Next game then, Sochi Juniors versus Dunipace, an all East of Scotland tie, and a good opportunity for both sides potentially to get in the third round to get a big, big draw.
I think that ties a belter, by the way. That'll be hammy and tongs. If I was a neutral looking at games to go to, that'd be right top of the list for this round.
Definitely.
I said about Dunipace, obviously, in terms of their quality and how I think they could be playing in the Premier and whatnot, but I'm not going to call that game. I actually think it could go either way, knowing what Sochi done last round. If they can get a cup run, it'll be fantastic for them. On the other hand, you could say the same for Dunipace as well. If they you know, third round of the Scottish Cup would be phenomenal for any sort of East of Scotland, even West of Scotland or South of Scotland team. So
I mean, you're looking at it, either of them get through, and potentially Sochi wise you could be facing Alloa, Dunipace could be facing Falkirk. There's all sorts of different ramifications. It's just League One goes on next round, and then Championship and the Premiership go together, I think,
okay.
I actually quite like the way they've set the Scottish Cup this year, with the slight changes they've made to the rounds, and there's no prelim type nonsense with buys all over the shop and all that. So I hope they keep it this way.
What they've done is they've cut out one prelim round, because it used to be a first and second, and now it's only one. So you get more ties with less buys, if that makes sense.
And that's the way it should be.
Next game then, Stenhouse Muir versus Huntley. That's another one for the Mick Kennedy travel agents. If Huntley the hotel, then you know who to call.
Away win. No, hi Cam, if you listen. Stenny should have too much for Huntley, but
they've got Daz Christie, so
they do have Daz Christie. Case closed.
Stenny,
they've not been great this year. They're waiting to click. I have heard for a couple of the boys there recently, and their mentality is, look, it's a matter of time. That they've not been getting the rub of the green. They just need a result or two, and they'll be flying. So there seems to be quite a positive dressing room still. They're just waiting to get moving, essentially.
I think they've had some issues in that, but they, you know, results don't lie. They are bottom of the league. But I do think they'll be better than Huntley. But I think they do have to get moving in the League Two, not to, to switch to the League Two podcast there. But I think, yeah, results need to come in the League Two just to get their confidence up as well.
But then again, a cup result can get you going in the league, eh? So it's a nice wee change.
Who knows? We might end up with Stenhouse Muir versus Broomhill next season in the lower league. That's
what I was looking for.
I mean, I wouldn't be averse to that.
Who knows? Two more games in left in the draw. It's St Cuthbert's Wanderers versus Galloway-Aberdeen Rovers. It's a, well, it's not all south of Scotland. It's a kind of south of Scotland tie, but obviously two different leagues here.
A battle of the south.
I actually looked at that tie, and I quite like that tie. I think it's an interesting one. I wouldn't rule out St Cuthbert's, but the way Gala went recently, you'd probably still favour them.
I think it'll be quite interesting to see where St Cuthbert's are, because they kind of come and go season to season. Sometimes they're brilliant, sometimes they're just mid-table in the south. Be a test of their title credentials, given that they could end up in a promotion playoff at the end of this season. So we'll see how they cope with Gala.
The final game then, and the third round draw, is Stranraer versus Darvel. This, actually, now thinking about it, could be the TV game. I'm thinking about it more and more that as we went through. Must have been, you were away there, we talked about potential TV matches, and Clydebank Elgin's is a possible shout there. But you might find that Stranraer Darvel could be the TV match. There's also a lot of talk about Darvel and playing a league side.
The other thing with the TV, bear in mind, is it would be a Monday night, so they've got away fans to think of. That might turn off Clydebank Elgin, because Elgin fans travelling there on a Monday might be a bit questionable. At least Stranraer Darvel's reasonably close to get a decent crowd there. I know Darvel don't have the biggest fan base in the west of Scotland, but it'd be an interesting tie for the neutral that might not know much about non-league. They might not know about Darvel. They suddenly find out the story. Might kind of turn them on to look at the West of Scotland League. Ultimately, that's what the Cup's about at this point, isn't it? We're trying to increase the interest in non-league. So I think it'd be a good tie to pick.
Stranraer, another team I think... I've not actually looked at them recently, but they were struggling, I believe, in the league. So these ones where like league teams are struggling compared to non-league teams that are kind of doing well always interest me to see how the form is going to go. And like you said, it could be a complete turnaround. You suddenly got a win in the Scottish Cup, the morales are up, and then it can completely change your season. So they'll be interesting. They'll be interesting to sort of keep an eye out for.
Just looking at it, they've come off a 2-0 win over Steny, but they've been beat by Edinburgh City, get a narrow win over Cowden, drew before first, so they're mid-table in League 2,
But interesting to see, but the million dollar question was, will Darvel have hotel room the night before?
One thing I need to actually, before we sort of finish up, Mozza, like say, for example, Broomhill were playing Steny, I mean, would you give Swifty a wee bit of abuse from the sidelines, like, hey, yeah, Muppet and all this sort of stuff, wouldn't it?
I wouldn't give him abuse. I'd maybe shout a good natured rub or two, as but
just constantly comedy boom. Boo!
I tell you, that's why I loved being at Edinburgh Uni. Not that I was shouting anything obscene in the Uni Derby, but I did like the fact that I was a wee bit not known, basically. So I could probably do that if I went to if I went to Bonnyrigg, I'd probably people would recognise me right away. So I wouldn't get in the door. So
troublemaker.
Well, that concludes the draw for the third round in our run through.
That sounded very official, that, didn't it? As if you've just pulled the balls out.
I was like that in my head. I was like, that's pure.
I'm ready to do my best Rod Stewart impression then.
He's been practicing that in his bedroom or something.
He's out for business here.
Yeah, lads, I'm a hired hat. I've been filming.
The third round draw by the official catch-up boys.
I've been filming cup draws recently, boys.
Very true.
I'm a professional in these parts these days. So that's the run through of the third round of the Scottish Cup. Just a shout out to our sponsors as always, Mick Kennedy Travel Agents. I'm joking, obviously. The Soccer Shop Direct, check out them on Twitter at the Soccer Shop D, or check out the website www.soccershopdirect.co.uk for all your
I can't wait for Mick to DM the account, by the way.
and equipment needs. I mean, that's it. I mean,
I'll forward it to you. I'll just spell it there, Ben.
It was all Ben.
Mike takes it well. He's going to take it well. Don't
that's your free Black Rooster's been forgotten about, isn't it?
Yeah. Well, it has. I mean, that's been like 2 years, and I'm still not. I'm not better. But yeah, thanks all for listening. Just before we go, where can we find you, Mozza?
At Mozza Plays on Twitter, and you'll find me everywhere else from there, basically. Chris?
At Rampant FM on Twitter, and you'll see a lot of FM stuff recently because I'm kind of a big deal in the community now, so I'm having one absolutely everything.
So he says.
But not the FM playoffs?
Not yet.
I've never, still waiting on my invite, mate. Still waiting on my invite.
Aye, so. Watch your space.
Obviously, get me on Twitter at Mr. Ben Grant. My messages have been a bit more fuller the last couple of weeks, so that's been interesting. Yeah, obviously we'll be back next week with more Lowland League action, but thanks for listening and catch you all soon.
Catches.